series is on AI solutions with Azure Machine Learning. So this series is sponsored by Synergetics and Microsoft. And also this series is organized by ATC community. So I would like to tell you about something about our Azure Tech community. Basically, last year we have started our ETC community and we have received so much great response in that community. And now we are started this Azure Tech community. So basically, this community is for all those people who are interested in latest technologies related all the Azure technologies. So basically, if you want to join this community, just visit our meetup group, which is Azure Tech Community, and you can join us there. So you will get all the updates about upcoming webinars and events and meetups directly. So just visit meetup, and in that meetup tool, you can search for Azure Tech Community, and you can just follow our community. So moving towards our today's webinar. Today's webinar is on AI solution with Azure Machine Learning. So basically, in today's webinar, you will learn how to use new machine learning designer tool to create experiments, train, deploy machine learning models on Microsoft Azure Machine Learning services. So basically, speaker of today's meetup is Chandrasekhar Deshpande, and he is an MCT. So I'll just give a introduction for him. So Chandrasekhar is a data all-rounder with unique blend of experience in multitude of data-related technologies. And he has more than 34 plus years of experience in this industry. So as I already told you, he's a Microsoft certified trainer. He is specialized in technologies like big data analytics, machine learning, Azure, Hadoop, and many more. And he has already worked with various Fortune companies like Accenture, Infosys, L&T, Intel, and many more. My words are really less to describe his great experience and work in this industry. So no doubt he will guide you properly regarding the all Azure AI technologies. Moving forward to before we start, I would like to tell you we have took this initiative under this Azure Tech community. We have started a meetup series. Under this meetup series, there are four meetups. So today we are having our first meetup. Other four meetups, I have displayed the calendar for other three meetups. So you can just enroll for these meetups. Can you please mute all yourself? So our next meetup is on 23rd May, 4 June and 18 June of this meetup series. I would like to tell you about our certification. So basically, master with Microsoft Azure certification virtual training. So why the certifications are important? So basically, certification, these are the four reasons you can see it. Certification bridges the gap between knowledge and skills, then becomes specialized in this particular technology area. Certification exhibit credibility and commitment. Certification courses do not to take long period of time. So why I'm telling this, because during this COVID situation, we all are at our homes. So basically, this is the best time we can utilize this time to do our Microsoft Azure certification just by sitting home. So we have already took some initiative about how you can attend this certifications, how you can complete this certification training and exam just by sitting home. So we have already conducted a webinar on that, how to take an online test in the past. So those who haven't attended this webinar, you can visit our YouTube channel. From there you can get to see
Thank you.
So moving forward about our training calendar, so you can see this this certification we are providing. Get the live training plus MOC plus exam voucher only for 17,500. So if you want this calendar, you can visit our website or you can mail me. All of you have probably have. So this is the special offer. So if you enroll for this courses or register for this courses. So if here we have given our contact person's number and mail ID, you can directly contact her, or if you want, you can also mail me. I'll just forward your query. Yes, so before we will start our webinar, I would like to tell you, once this webinar meetup is over, we are going to send you an email which consists of a feedback form, a survey form, and you just need to fill that both the form. After that, you will get the participation certificate of this meetup. And one more thing, we have shared this link through WhatsApp as well as from our mail. So this link is shareable with your colleagues and friends. So many of you may have not registered for this meetup. So if you want the participation certificate, you just need to send me your details through email, or so I can share the feedback form or survey form with you. So after, only after that, I am able to give you a participation certificate. So thank you very much. We will start our webinar. Thank you so much. Chandrasekhar sir, now you can start with the webinar.
Thanks, Priyanka. Chandrasekhar here. And I think I'm reaching to everybody here through audio. In case if you have any problem, let us know. Yes, and I'm also sharing my screen. So in case if it does not reach to you, please let me know. So I believe it is reaching to you. And let me quickly, first of all, explain you the agenda for this discussion, as well as what are all main focus of this discussion today. We will be understanding data science and different roles in this particular domain. So what is the role and responsibility of data engineer, data scientist, and developer, and other stakeholders here. We will also understand what exactly CI/CD pipeline means in machine learning. We will understand what are all different tools and services available here on Azure for constructing, Azure ML pipeline. What are all different services available? We will visit one of the well-known service, ML service, Azure ML service. Okay, and we will work with that service by using designer, by using notebook, by using something called as an auto ML. So in the available time, I will try to cover as much as I can. Here, I will try to explain you the conceptual things, but maybe because of not enough time available, I will visit the conceptual thing, but I will not put, you know, much more explanation on that. That is expected to be done specifically in the certification course. What are all services available and how to deal with the services? That will be the another focus of today's discussion. So ML being one of the very hot topic as on today, and it is almost emerged technology, and it has moved to the next level of the technology, and it is a cognitive services, sentiment analysis, image processing. So the technology has got enough maturity, and many companies are already implementing in this scenario as on today. Also, if you see this COVID-19 apps are there, and then there are different websites which are showing us how this virus is getting spreaded and in how much time, how much will be the severity of the virus, within 15 days, how much will be the severity of the virus. All these are the things, you know, predicted through analytics only and machine learning only. So somewhere machine learning not only is playing its role as on today, but, you know, till yesterday also it was playing a role, specifically in my life when I used to start a Google map in the morning before I take a move to the office. And that Google map used to suggest me which, you know, road I should follow, which path I should follow to reach to the office. So different use cases. Let me just start this. So in the industry, sales and other predictions are easily done, and there the only alternative available is the machine learning. Reduce hospital readmissions. As on today also, symptoms are given, and then there are applications which are, you know, suggesting whether a patient is due for the admission to the hospital. There are applications which are even giving the prediction of to which disease these symptoms will lead to. Identify insured property. So many different use cases are there. AMA Turnpike bill for license plate. This is what is recently implemented here in India. When we go by the road, say we have to pay toll tax. And nowadays, what is happening is the system has been automated, and the system is picking up the details of the vehicle and accordingly automatically deducting the toll tax from the registered account number. So automatically picking up the vehicle details and then processing the overall system to do the automatic deduction. Again, it needs something called as the image processing or signal processing or IoT processing, and that is what happening as on today. So there are a number of use cases for this particular field as on today. These are some of the steps to be followed in this process. So just quickly go through. In case if you have already worked a little on the analytics, then I don't think it is something new for you. Data cleansing. We get the data in the variety of the formats. We are getting the data from the variety of the resources. Okay, and we are getting the data with a variety of the velocities also. So variety of the data type, variety of the resources, variety of the velocity. So there are different challenges because of these different varieties. And there is a reason for evolving of the big data and analytical system as on today. Whenever we are getting the data, we may not get the data in a completely cleaned format. We have to clean the data. We have to prepare the data for applying ML algorithms. So there may be some preparation we have to do. Sometimes there are outliers. We may have to remove the outliers, and we have to ensure better quality of the data before we put that data for further processing. We have to do a feature engineering. Feature engineering means whenever we are collecting the data, not whole data can predict the target prediction. Cannot predict the target. So for example, if I want to predict the sales, I have sales data since couple of days, couple of months, and I want to predict the sales maybe next month or next year. So sales prediction is the target, but for that purpose, what are all columns need? Hello? Hello? Will you please keep yourself on mute? Please keep yourself on mute. Okay. So in order to predict the cells, I need some values to do the correct prediction. Those values, those column values are called as a feature. And then converting my data to make it suitable for feature, suitable for training and evaluation purpose, there comes the feature engineering. I have to create something called as a machine learning model. I have to submit this data to the model. we call that process as a training. So we train that model on this historical data. And when that model gets trained on the historical data, more rigorous the training is, more accuracy we can see for that model in prediction. It can do nearer predictions. So training of the model is very important state. Whenever we train the model, then we have to evaluate it. Evaluation of the model, in the sense we have to calculate the performance of the model. We have to calculate the performance of the model. Now, what is exactly performance? Here we don't talk with respect to the resource consumption in terms of the performance. We talk about how accurately that model can do the prediction. So that is called as a performance. So that evaluation we have to do. Now, sometimes what happens that one model may not give me expected say performance. So I have to, you know, create a different models. Again, this is not, till yesterday it was not done automatically. We have to, you know, manually create multiple models. You have to calculate their performance and we have to compare the performances, and the best model we have to choose. But today we will see that actually this process, manual process, is very rigorous and time consuming. Okay, but what Azure has done is they have introduced something called as Azure Auto ML, where I don't have to create n number of models and do the comparison. Auto ML itself automatically creates n number of models, does the performance evaluation, and chooses the best performing model. And that can be deployed for the purpose of the production. Anybody can send the data, and this model can do the prediction on the data. So there comes the prediction. So this stage gives me the prediction at the production level. So these are multiple steps in data science processing. There are different rules also associated with it. Just a minute. Okay. So let us have this understanding of these tips in further details. So see, business understanding, company might have lost the sale because of maybe whenever there was a peak of the demand, at that time inventory got exhausted and production could not be done mapping to the need of the, or mapping to the demand in the industry. So we might have run our, we might have exhausted the industry. Now it is essential for us to find out the reason for why we have exhausted the inventory. So basic understanding of the business problem, that is the first step. Once we realize that exactly what has gone wrong, then we understand. Hello, will you please keep your cell phone mute? Please keep your cell phone mute. Hello. Okay. Now here from the data, data scientists have to find out the different patterns and accordingly so they have to prepare the data and they have to create the models. So data scientists explore the data, find out the data which is necessary. We may be having huge quantum of the data. Not all data can do the predictions or can participate in doing the predictions. So what is necessary is we have to, data scientist has to explore the data, find the pattern in the data, and then he has to prepare the data. So he may have to cleansing the data. He may have to decide what kind of transformations we have to apply, because you know there may be outlier, there may be missing values. So he has to decide the policies for replacing the missing values. He has to decide the policies for applying the different kinds of transformations. So I will be designing one data pipeline specifically in the designer. So there I will be visiting these steps again. Then we have to create a model. The historical data is to be the cleaned data, and the transformed data we have to submit to the model. And this model is nothing but an in-memory object, which is comprising of two things. One is machine learning algorithm, These are statistical, mathematical, and analytical algorithms.
Bye.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Yes, 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 Shekhar.
My screen is reaching to you, right?
Yes, yeah. Yes, yes. Please go ahead.
Okay, so I will be visiting these steps again, specifically whenever I will be designing a data pipeline in the designer. So in case if there are not, there is some lack of clarity, don't bother much about it. I will be giving you clarity whenever I am following these steps specifically in the designer. So once the model is created, then we have to do the evaluation. That means the performance of the model we have to calculate. Whenever we create the one model, okay, most probably it will not give me the expected performance. So what normally I have to do is I have to create a multiple models, and I have to compare the performances of these multiple models and find out the best performing model. And that best performing model is mean for giving me best accuracy among the models I have created, best accuracy of the prediction. And then I have to deploy that best performing model that will be for production environment. That deployment I will have to do for the production environment. Okay, so these are the different processes I have to follow in data science. Model training life cycle, I will come back to this later. Okay, just a minute. Then come to this diagram. This diagram will now give me more insight of what type of steps I have to follow, okay, while training the model and while using it in the prediction. So here you observe, I have historical data which I want to use to train the model and which I want to use to analyze the performance of the model. So what I am doing here is I am splitting that data into two parts. So out of complete data, I may be having 80% of rows to train the data and 20% of data may be for the purpose of the testing. I will come to testing soon, but whenever I talk about the training of the data, why do I go with 80% of data for the training? The reason is, more the data I submit to the training okay, more is the accuracy. So that's why 80% of data we are submitting to the training. And what it does here is, okay, it applies the feature engineering, transformation, cleaning, and all those things. Then it creates the model. Now this is machine learning model. I repeat again, this model has two components. One is the machine learning algorithm, and another is the data which has been submitted to it and from which it has created one in-memory model. This model is now, you know, ready for the prediction purpose. So this model is created. I have to find out the accuracy of the model. In order to calculate the accuracy of the model, I may be submitting that 20% of data. So this is a testing phase. Here, that 20% of data will be submitted. That 20% of data also has, because this is historical data, so it also has predictions, but I will say these are facts. These are the results. Okay, so what it will do is it will submit the data to the created model, and from the created model, it will do its own prediction, which will it match with the results of the historical data. So results of the historical data, for example, just let me tell you one more example. This example I will be conducting in designer also. So there is a data of different bank customers. Okay, their financial status, their family status has been submitted, and whether they are successfully returned the loan, that has been mentioned. So loan status has also been mentioned. So from the financial status, we want to predict the loan status, whether from the financial status and from the other factors which may directly contribute to successful return of the loan. Okay, so all those factors are the feature factors. And the loan status, whether he has successfully returned a loan or not, that is the prediction. Okay, so here what kind of data I will be doing is, I will be submitting feature data to it and prediction data also. This is the prediction data. This is not a prediction data, but this is the loan status data that these customers have returned the loan. Okay, and from there, then I will ask the model to do the predictions. And then these predictions we will have to match with the loan status. That prediction then we will have to match with the loan status. So whenever it is matched with the loan status, there I will come to know how accurately my model is doing the prediction. There, then the performance of the model is evaluated, and such a best performing model then we will deploy for the production purpose. So I'm bypassing some of the slides which are taking me to the deeper knowledge of the study. Okay, so I'm taking you to the important points only. These are different services available on the Azure. Azure Machine Learning, Azure Databricks, Azure Data Science Virtual Machine. So I will be quickly taking you on walk for introducing these services. Azure Machine Learning Service. This provides me complete end-to-end solution for developing the machine learning pipeline, data pipeline as well as processing pipeline. It also allows me to endpoints to deploy the created model. It allows me to create a number of models to do their comparisons and choose the best one and then deploy it for the production. So for end-to-end solution of ML and deep learning, neural analytics, and cognitive services, we have Azure Machine Learning Service. Only one service to provide you, okay, many features, specifically in the domain of machine learning. Okay, now in Azure Machine Learning, they have introduced something called as the Azure Machine Learning Designer. Okay, Studio is its old name. Now its new name is a Designer. So we will use a Designer also. Designer is a tool to design a data pipeline without writing any code. It is a graphical tool. You can just drag and drop the things and create your complete ML pipeline. So very handy tool. In very less time, you can design ML pipeline. Okay, so there we will have an introduction to Azure Machine Learning Designer. Databricks is an open source available in the market to do the similar, to provide you the similar end-to-end development platform. Azure has collaborated with the Databricks and has provided first-class citizen. Databricks has a first-class citizen on Azure. So Databricks also can be used to design end-to-end machine learning pipeline. So here we have two solutions for designing end-to-end machine learning pipeline: Azure Databricks and Azure Machine Learning Service. Azure Machine Learning Service is given completely by Azure. Azure Databricks has been given, introduced through the collaboration of Azure and Databricks. Azure Data Science Virtual Machine is a ready virtual machine what Azure is offering to you. And in this virtual machine, you can start directly working because you are getting a ready environment. Ready environment of Python, ready environment of different libraries, ready environment of GPU arrangements. So in order to do analytical processing, machine learning, okay, and advanced machine learning, everything that is necessary has been provided to you ready. So you don't have to spend your time in creating the environment. You will get ready environment through Azure Data Science virtual machine. Azure server machine, SQL server machine learning services. Now what they Azure has started is they have started introducing the, all these analytics and machine learning features into SQL server, SQL data warehouse. So there also now Microsoft has started introducing analytical processing features. So data science virtual machine, I already told you about. This is Azure Machine Learning Designer. I just fast forwarded it because I will be introducing this designer to you soon. So I'm just fast forwarding it. SQL Machine Learning Server. This is SQL Server as you would have worked with it in past, but this server has now been provided with analytical services. Spark on Azure HD Insight. Azure HD Insight is a ready Hadoop platform. It is ready Hadoop platform. Okay, you don't have to spend time in creating a Hadoop environment. You will get a ready Hadoop environment through HD Insight. It implements, it has been designed using Hortonworks platform. Okay, and it is for massive scale. Now on Hadoop platform, if you are using Apache Spark, here you are getting ready Apache Spark. Okay, Apache Spark basically does this big data processing, in-memory processing. It uses a hard disk as least as it can. And that's why processing speed is very high with a Spark. It is too high with a Spark compared to Hadoop platform. Okay, so they are giving you Spark ready on Azure HD Insight. Although this Spark is available on Databricks also. In Databricks, okay, Spark is a core processing engine. So Spark you get there also. Spark you can get here also. And the Spark, what you get there and here, one and the same. Okay, so features of Spark are as they are. Azure Databricks, I already told you that this is a Databricks is Apache's freeware product. Azure has collaborated with them and has introduced Databricks as a first class citizen here on the Azure. So it is full of features of not only Databricks but features offered by Azure also. So security and different tools, portal is also available, and down the line in internally, Spark works as an engine there. Okay, so I think it is the time for me to jump to the service now. In order to save the time, what I have done is I have already created the service. And creating the service is not at all a big deal. It is a matter of 10-15 minutes. So here, I have created a service. Now, in order to create a service, what I have to do simply is, I have to go to the resource group. I believe all of you already have worked with the Azure. So I am just sticking myself to the portion which is meant for Azure ML service. Okay, so this is the resource group. And in this resource group, in case if I want to create a service, so I can click here and I can machine learning. I can submit machine learning. So machine learning is a service available there. This is complete managed service. So when I choose for the machine learning, if I click on create, okay, it will ask me some information, which on the submission, okay, now what kind of information does it ask me just to see? It is very easy to create the machine learning service. It is asking me the name of the workspace, the subscription, the resource group, the location, okay, and edition. Now, workspace name, what exactly the workspace name is? workspace is a storage inside which my business assets are maintained. So whatever be the Python code I will write, whatever be the pipeline I will design, whatever be the different artifacts I will create here, okay, all these things are maintained within the workspace. So I have to give one name to the workspace. This name has to be unique in the resource group. Subscription, resource group, location, and edition. Now, in order to get a designer and advanced features, I have to choose for enterprise. I will not choose for business. So once I submit this information, I will click here, and then it will start creating this service. I already have created one service, so I am taking you to that service. So here, I have created one service, Azure ML Workspace. So here, I have created one service. After it creates the service, it will show me the service blade, something like this. So this is machine learning service. And this machine learning service has its own portal. That portal I can launch from here. Okay, launch now. So it will take me to the portal. Okay, and it will take me to the this kind of portal. So Azure Machine Learning Service is ready. Now here we will come to the portal. What Azure Machine Learning Service offers me, that I already have mentioned, but let me revise it again, that it provides me a way to design ML pipeline, okay, end to end. So I will, there are a number of connectors available here. I can use those connectors to connect to a variety of the data sources. I can collect the data. I can apply different cleansing mechanisms. All these things I can do here in ML service. I can apply different transformation mechanisms. I can make my data ready for feature engineering. Then I can do a feature engineering. After I do a feature engineering, then I can create a model. I can choose multiple models and I can create multiple models and his data I can submit to the model. Then I can score the model. I mean to say, I can calculate the performance of the model. I can evaluate the model in the sense I can scoring means I can do the testing and then I can calculate the performance in the evaluation. Okay, so I can evaluate the model. I can choose the best performing model. Then I can deploy that model on production environment. So Kubernetes-like environment I can deploy. And it allows me to test the model also. Okay, now in the production, whenever data comes, real-time data comes from the client side, that data we can cache also, and that data again after some time we can use for the training purpose, and we can enrich the model with the newly generated data. So all these things are possible here. So let me quickly take you to these things. See, here is
it's not audible.
Yeah, not audible.
Since how long I am not audible?
1 to 2 minutes.
Okay. Okay. So let me repeat the things which in the meantime I might have covered. So here is a portal view. Okay. And here is a data store. Data store, what data store is, what compute is, and all these things I will explain you one by one. So data store represents the connection. I already have created one connection to refer to the storage. So I have created one storage here. So I take you to the storage to show you what I have done there. So in this storage, this is a normal Azure account storage. I have created one container there with the name data. Okay, and in that container, I have uploaded one CSV file. This is a CSV file. Loans is CSV file. I will show you the content of this file also. In order to connect to this storage, I have created a data store here. Okay, so when I click on a new storage, okay, storage name, it accept from me, data store type, to see n number of data stores or connections available here. I can choose one of them and I can create that connection to refer to that specific data store. Okay, subscription, storage account name, block container name, this is normal information I have to give, and my resource may be created using private key. I mean to say, I have added a restriction over the resources, over the files and over the container. So I have to give account key here. Okay, I can give SAS token or account key. So SAS token is granular accession to the resource. Account key is a complete access extension to the resource. So one of the key I can mention here, and now hereby I am providing access to this Azure machine learning, okay, to the storage. So after this storage connection is created, hello,
can we integrate Azure Key Vault here?
Azure Key Vault is to be integrated with a storage. I don't have to associate Key Vault with a machine learning. I have to associate with the storage, because everything that goes on the storage, okay, it will have to pick up the default key on the Key Vault, or it may have to pick up the key, customized key. And through that key, then that storage will return the data to us. It will do encryption, decryption, and will return the data to us.
Yes.
So, okay. So then I have to create a data set. Now, what exactly data set is? The data set is representing the actual data with a schema. So here I am choosing for the data set. Okay, I can create a new data set. Here what I have done is, I have created a data set from store, data store. Okay, and which is referring to this loan data CSV file. This CSV file is the CSV file I have uploaded on the storage. Okay. So in this CSV file, the first row is representing, very first representing the schema, all headers of the CSV, okay, and remaining rows are representing actual data. So that schema and actual data is being declared here. Okay, so it is representing, or it is defining the schema. Okay, and a file, actual file. Once I declare or create the data set, okay, here are the data sets I have created. Sorry, this is the data set I have created. From here, I can create a new data set. So creating a data set again is very simple. It is just a matter of couple of clicks. After I do this, I have to, multiple data sets also can be created. Multiple data sets can be created. So I am going to designer now. Okay, earlier we used to call it as a studio, but now that old studio is being called as a classic studio. And here now we are using a new terminology, something called as a designer. So I am opening the designer. Okay, and in the designer, one complete pipeline I already have created. I will show you how to create a new pipeline. Okay, but otherwise, let me show you. Let me take you to the already created pipeline. So here is one pipeline I already have created. I will explain you the things step by step. Hello, any question, please?
Can you please mute all, then someone is coming back.
Sorry.
Can you meet everyone?
Because someone... Yes. Okay. So how do I create a new pipeline? So creating a new pipeline is very simple. I want to create a new pipeline. I can create one blank new empty pipeline. Otherwise, some sample pipelines they are already giving. Okay, for the study purpose and for further understanding, you can refer to them. I am clicking here. Okay, and here it has created one new pipeline. Okay, I can change the name of the pipeline. So this is a test predict done. Some name I can give to it. Okay, and it has created the pipeline. Now on this pipeline, okay, I have to drag and drop because this is a GUI available. Okay, so here if you see, there are different data sets available. Here are different data sets. This is the data set which I have created. But otherwise, there are a number of data sets they are giving to me for the running purpose. These are sample data sets they are giving. So automatic automobile price data, okay, or this is a loan data. This is I have created. These are all sample data they are providing to me. I can drag it. So left key of the mouse and I am dragging it. And here is the data set. It has dragged. Now I want to see the data. So this is activity. Okay. And in this activity, this is the configuration of the activity. Okay. So data set name and other information you can see here to which a file this data set is referring to. That is also mentioned here. Output. Now I can see the data from here. So I'm clicking on the visual and I can see the data here. And observe here, there are 613 rows in this data set and there are 14 columns. Okay, loan ID, gender, marital status, dependence, education, a number of columns are there. Okay, this is whole historical data and this is a loan status. Loan was granted to these customers and whether
so, they... this is from the CSV, correct?
Which, sorry?
This like data you pick from the CSV, from the block storage.
This CSV, this is what I uploaded into storage. So from this CSV, now I can see the data.
Hello. Sir, I have a question. Like if you want to clean the data set, like there are a number of cleaning steps we perform. So how can we do that in this
cleaning of data? Yes, I will show you a couple of cleaning steps also. This is the very first step that I have to do I have to pull the data first. Okay, and then we will apply cleaning and transformation. So those are steps also I will explain you. But the point here is, this is the way I have to get the data. Okay, and from this data, just two things would like to bring to your notice that the first row is representing header schema. The head row is representing schema. So it has automatically understood that it has to pick up the schema from the first row and the remaining rows are representing actual data. If I want to see the central tendency of every data, every column, okay, I can choose that column and here it will show me a central tendency. Okay, so here it is showing me that there is no missing value in this. So may not be in this column, maybe in some another column, there may be missing values, okay. But I can choose a column and it can show me not only central tendency, it also can show me the spread of the data, spread of the values. Okay, so here, applicants' income. Okay, spread of the values are being shown here. And here you will realize that most of the customers are in this range. And there are very few customers, okay? In this range, very few customers in this range, okay, and we will consider this particular value as an outlier and we will try to understand how can we overcome the outliers also. Co-applicant, so here is the there are outliers for the co-applicants also. So there are applicants and co-applicants. So my next step will be to so fix this problem. But there are outliers, and I want to remove those outliers. Okay, so for that purpose, let me take you. But here from this, okay, I will have to pick up the, you know, activity one by one, and I'll have to drag it here. Okay, so one ready pipeline I already have designed for you. So I am taking you to that pipeline. So here it is. Just a minute, not here. I think I have chosen wrong pipeline. Yes. Here it is. Huh. Okay. Now here, what I have to do is, I have realized that there are outliers in applicants' income and co-applicants' income. So I will first of all sum them up. And then the total income, what I will get, will be with less number of outliers. So this is one measure I will take to, you know, reduce the outliers. So what I am deciding is to, you know, apply mathematical function here. So when I am dragging it, now see, apply mathematical operation. It comes under transformation. So here is a apply mathematical operation. Okay, so inside transformation, adding new columns or adding the columns from the another data set, adding or appending rows from the another data set, doing some mathematical operation. Okay, so different kind of cleansing mechanisms and transformation mechanisms are available here. So clean missing data, I will come to this later. Okay, but for, I want to sum applicant's income and co-applicant's income. That's why I have chosen for math operation. So which operation? It is operation. Okay, not comparison, not rounding, okay, not trigonometric operation. So it is simple mathematical operation. So I have chosen a category. I have chosen actual arithmetic operation here. I want to do add there. Okay, so one argument is APPL income. Another argument is co-APPL income. If I want to choose a specific column, I can click here. It will show me the list of the columns here. And from that list, here you observe, the moment I clicked here, it is showing me the list. I can choose a column from here. Okay, so from here, I have chosen for APPL income. Okay, and similarly, similarly, another column I have chosen, and I am choosing for append. I just do not want it to make the correction into same column. I just do not want it to update APPL column. I want it to add the third column there. Okay, and that is append. So if I want to do the changes into the same column, I would have chosen for in place. Okay, so I am choosing for append. And now see, whenever I add this activity and I want to run this activity, okay, what I have to do is, I have to create something called as a compute. Okay, in order to run this activity, I have to create the compute. So here, if I take you to the compute, okay, there are four types of computes here. This is basically for notebook. This is basically for running the activity that I am adding into the designer. So this compute is necessary. And I already have created one compute here. If I want to create a new compute, okay, here it is asking me the name of the compute. Here it is asking me the region. It is asking me virtual machine type. So it is a CPU. I don't have GPU like workload to execute there. Okay, virtual machine size from here. So I have taken minimum virtual machine size because this is just for the testing purpose. Okay, and my workload is also small. It has only 613 rows. But if you have huge size of data, then you have to choose, okay, better machine and more nodes for the machine. So here, okay, I have to mention minimum number of nodes. Here I have to mention maximum number of nodes. So scalability factor I can mention here. Okay, and in case if my cluster remains idle for X time duration, then it should start shutting down the cluster. So how much time, okay, my cluster should remain idle before it is shut down. Okay, that information I will have to mention here on the same line. I already have created one compute for you. So I have created one compute for you. Okay, the information of the compute is already being shown here. Status of that compute also can be shown here. Okay, so one compute I already have made ready for you. Okay, so what I can go is I can go to that designer tool, and if I want to run these steps, what I can do is submit. With the submit, what it will do, whatever be the actions I have added, those actions it execute. Okay, now I have executed it. Okay, when I execute it, okay, just a minute. Yes, so you see here, from here I have to set the compute target, which I already have set to C compute. So I have set the compute target also. Okay, so what it will be doing is it will add two columns, applicants income and co-applicants income. Those two columns it will add. Yes. After that, I will go to, if you see here, now I will have to remove this to put it to run. Otherwise, it will run whole pipeline. Let me submit it and let me see, it will run the pipeline one by one. Okay, submit. Here, compute is being given, experiment is also being given. What is experiment? Now, what we are designing is a pipeline. Whenever we put this pipeline to run, okay, and multiple times when we run it, somewhere we have to have an object which will hold status and details of every execution. That is experiment. Experiment hold status of every execution. Now it is running. So this particular step it has executed. Okay, let me show you, it is executing the steps one by one. So wherever it is showing me green means that step it has executed. Okay, and in case if, now this pipeline I already executed earlier, that's why it could complete the execution quickly. Okay, but whenever it has executed, now I can see the output of this. So output and logs. So when I take you to this, okay, it will show me the output of that data frame. And here you observe there are still 613 rows, but remember now there is one additional column here. If you, I take you to that column, what it has done is these two columns, APPL income and applicant income and co-applicant income, it has added in the third column, of which the name is add co-applicant, applicant, some unwanted name it has given to it, given to this column. Okay, so two columns have been added and it is giving me the third column. On this, the third column, if I want to apply changing the name of the column, then I have to apply edit metadata. Metadata means column names we can change, column types we can change. Okay, so edit metadata. To the edit metadata, I will ask, or I will mention the column name I am mentioning here. Data type I don't want to change, category I don't want to change, field I don't want to change, I want to apply new name to it. So this column name will be changed. So in the output, I can show you that column name has been changed. And now there is no column of add a name. The column is total income. So multiple such steps we can apply. Now here perhaps I am applying log function to it. Now why I am applying log function to it? Why do I need to apply log function? Let me tell you that reason also. Now if I am going to show you the tendency of the total income, here is a tendency of the total income. And in this tendency, you will still realize that outliers are not completely fixed. So I will have to apply log function there, log 10 function there. It does not change the feature of the data, but it properly spreads the data. Okay, so as of now, see that curve is not bell curve. Okay, I want to see a bell curve for total income. Okay, so curve is not bell curve. Okay, so what I want to do is I want to apply a log function there. So what I have done is, again, I have chosen apply math operation. And here I am applying log. Log of 10, on which column? Total income. And I want it to create a new column. Okay, so after this, if I see the data, okay, now here you will see that it has created one additional column. So this is a new column it has created after applying the log function on total income. And now here, if you see the tendency, okay, now it is almost a bell curve. It is almost a bell curve. Okay, so without changing the feature, now it has given me proper quality of the data. So basically, these steps I can use to improve the quality of the data. Name of that column is not proper. So I may change the name of the column. So here I am changing the name of the column, and I am giving it a name, total income log. This name I am giving to it. Okay, if I want to clean the data, so cleaning option is available here under a data transformation. Clean missing data that I can drag and place here. Okay. Now, column wise cleaning I can do. Okay. What I am doing is just one straightforward and rudimentary way I am applying here to do the cleaning. I have chosen all the columns. Now, how I can choose all the columns? Again, edit columns, the columns on which I want to apply the cleaning. Okay, and from here, column names, no, I am choosing for all columns. So after I have chosen for all columns, okay, minimum missing value ratio, maximum missing value ratio, that range I can apply, and cleaning modes. Here you will observe multiple cleaning modes. If I am choosing one column, and on that column, if I want to apply, okay, replace with mean, that is possible. Okay, replace with mode, replace with median. I am choosing for remove entire row. So in case if at least one column is missing, I am removing entire row. Okay, but otherwise, replacing a missing value with the mean of all the data, median of all the data, or mode of all the data, you can choose from here. So after cleaning, okay, again I will have to submit. It thought it, I have made some changes there.
Why do we use a bell curve? What is the advantage of that?
Bell curve is considered to be best quality data. The curve, in case if it's shifted to the left or is shifted to the right, okay, such a data is considered to be, okay, data not spreaded properly, but either shifted to the left or shifted to the right. most of the values are from the left side or with low values or with the high values. So bell curve, advantage of bell curve is that bell curve data is always considered to be best quality data. So normally what data scientist does is,
I have a doubt, if bell curve is considered as the best data, then we can use a technique called as standard normal variate, which can convert any data into like into Gaussian curve. So
yes,
can we use that?
Yes. So see, there are many ways available. I have used a log function there, but if you see that activity, apply math function. If you see that activity, okay, in that activity, not here, there are standard variations, different functions we can apply, variety of functions we can apply. So here, see the whole list of the functions we can apply. Here, if you go, different kinds of categories are available. Okay, so operations, rounding, special, trigonometric, different kinds of categories are available here. So different policies are there, different techniques are there. I tried applying a log function here to get the data into the form of the bell curve, but there are a number of different strategies available here. From here, you can apply those strategies. But this is the way, so lots of options available. Okay, this is the way you can choose and drag the data, action here, and accordingly configure as per your requirement. That you can do.
But I have a question over here. So in the data set, if we say that 80% of the rows were having a salary of 5,000 rupees and 20% of rows were having a salary of 2,000 rupees. So by doing a bell curve, what are we doing? We are actually changing the data?
Yes. What it does is it changes the data and it tries to fit the data into smaller range. So if I take you to the, where did I do that? Just a minute. If I take you to the result of this edit metadata, okay, where I'm choosing, changing the column names, let us see the values. It applies the log on the data. It applies
Yeah, I cannot see your screen now. All of a sudden, it has gone away, the sharing.
Let me check. So, do you want me to reshare the screen?
Yeah, if you can please reshare your screen because I cannot see your screen now. Thank you.
Now, let me know whether the screen is reshared.
Yes, we can see this.
So log I applied there. There are a number of other ways also. Okay. But without losing the meaning of the data, range of the data is changed. Okay. So log also we can use for prediction purpose.
Sorry, we are not seeing.
Even I am not able to see it till now also. I'm not able to see your screen.
We are not able to see.
Yeah, I also.
Screen is not visible.
Okay.
Your name, CD is visible.
Let me check it again. Let me share it again. Okay, let me know if it is visible. Otherwise, I will change the internet connection then.
No, it is visible.
No, for me, it is still not visible as of now.
Even I can't see.
It's not visible. Okay, I'm changing internet connection and
No. We can see. I mean, the person who are not able to see is like they have a weak net connection.
No, my connection is
when you said that he cannot see it, before that your screen was visible. The person was, when he was saying that I cannot see your screen, at that time your screen was visible. But when you change, then it stopped displaying.
Right.
Okay, I am resharing the screen now. Right. Now let us wait for 2 minutes. The moment the screen reaches to you, let me know this.
Now we can see.
Huh. Okay. What about others?
No.
No, I can't. No.
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 I can't.
No.
I
can't. No, I can't. No, I can't.
But now I have changed my internet connection, so I don't think now there should be issue. Let us wait for a while because it takes a bit more time to reach to you.
Okay, let's do one.
Yeah,
thing.
I can. Let's reconnect. Now able to see. Now able to see.
Okay, so
I see the screen.
Now most of us can see the screen. Okay, so I'm coming back to the screen missing data. Here I already brought to your notice that different cleaning techniques we can apply. Okay, in cleaning mode, I can choose which cleaning technique I want to apply. So maybe custom value substitution, maybe replacing missing values with a mean, medium, or mode, or removing entire row or removing entire column. Different measures I can choose. I'm choosing one rudimentary measure here, removing entire row. Okay. And yes, after that, okay, I want to see the output, okay, result. Now here when I see visuals, okay, I can see there are 613 records. It means none of the row has any missing value. My data is missing value free data. But in case if had there been some missing value, it would have removed that row, complete row, it would have removed. So after, say, in case if I want to do multiple cleanings, then multiple activities, I will have to add cleaning activities, I will have to add. Okay, again, from here, I will have to drag clean missing data, okay, here. And after that, then here I am applying an activity, filter-based feature selection. Know what exactly this is and from where this comes, filter based. So what I can do is I can just search for that activity filter. It will narrow down the search and it is showing me that it is from the feature selection. Now what basically it does is, in case if I want to know what it is doing is, okay, I can I can see the documentation also. So here you will see help documentation. So from here, you can see what that feature, that activity is meant for. This activity basically is to identify.
The screen is not visible.
Sorry? It is also screen? Invisible, not visible.
Right, so not visible for me also.
Yeah, maybe someone only is getting visible. We are not able to.
Because now see, I have chosen proper internet. I don't think the issue is from my side.
No, we are not able to. The thing is, I am having a good, very good connection, very high speed of internet broadband, but it seems the issue is with the Teams Microsoft website or something like that. It's not at your end. I agree.
Yes, I also have a high speed Wi-Fi.
Is anybody able to see the screen?
No.
Okay,
no,
I have re.
No, I can't.
Now it is visible. I have reshared it. So now definitely some of us will be able to see it. I will wait for a while because, you know, sometimes it may lag. Your screen may lag. So let me wait for a while.
I think for future sessions, it would be better to have it in Zoom or some other. In some other medium.
Your suggestion is noted. Okay, I will convey it to the right people, but don't know whether it will be possible or not, because after all, these sessions are being offered for by Microsoft.
Okay.
Yeah, see the
session. Yeah, till now the session is quite informative and I appreciate it.
Yes, yes, I am waiting for a while. Just let me know whether screen reaches to you.
Yeah, the screen is visible.
Yeah, screen okay. is visible.
Okay.
For me, it is still not visible, but you can continue so that we will not waste any time.
Yes, yes, yes. So here, filter-based feature selection, what it will do, try to understand. Okay, it is asking me which correlation it has to apply. What it is, it will be doing, try to understand. There are around, you know, 14 rows. There are 14 columns, not 14 rows, sorry, 14 columns. My loan status, which is nothing but a value which I want to predict. Based on these 14 values, I want to know whether customer will be in capacity of paying the loan back. That is loan status. Out of these 14 columns, whether all the columns are participating in the prediction, or there may be some column, okay, which are not at all participating in prediction. Just to cite one example. Now, for the customer, okay, his financial status, his family status, his responsibilities, okay, family responsibilities and responsibilities of paying other loans, that will decide whether he will have a capacity in paying back this load, in paying back this loan. What all factors which are not participating in projection are his body weight, his height. These are immaterial factors. Okay, so we may have that data also. We have to find out which data will participate in prediction and which data is irrelevant for prediction. So for that purpose, we will use this filter-based feature selection. There are different types of you know, correlation techniques available to calculate the feature features. So I am choosing the very simple and mostly used feature here, Pearson correlation. Okay, and when I choose it and I go here, okay, in the execution I will see a filtered data set. Okay, now this filtered data set will not have all 14 columns. Okay, one more thing I forgot to show to you. What it does is, now this feature, this value I have forgot to mention, target column, I know it is loan status. Number of desired features. Number of desired feature means how many features I want to pick up. What it will be doing is it will apply some mathematical, analytical, and statistical functions to find out the measure of the dependency, factor of the dependency of that particular column on the loan status. So there may be one column providing me higher dependency, and there may be another column giving me least dependency. So here I am choosing 9. Thereby, I am intimating it to choose the topmost 9 columns which will have highest dependency on doing the prediction of the loan status. I can change this number. If I change it to 5, it will choose the topmost 5 columns only, okay, which will decide the loan status. But smaller is a count, smaller is this number, okay, faster is the processing, but will give me performance, it will affect the performance also. Okay, so that's why you have to give, you have to, you know, make a trade-off here. Larger number of columns will slow down the performance, slow down the processing, but will give me better performance. Smaller number of columns will give me execution performance good, but prediction performance less. Okay, so one number I am choosing here. After that, then if you see the output, in this output here you will see it is giving me 10 columns. One first column is a identity column. Okay, 10 columns. So first column is a identity column. Okay. Here is identity column. Okay, but remaining columns, so these are the columns what it is giving me, which are mostly participating in the prediction. Any column if I choose, okay, it gives me central tendency of that column. Okay, so I have identified some 10 columns. So there is an algorithm in ML, principal component analysis. that algorithm also does the same thing, and internally, okay, this feature is using that algorithm to identify, okay, which columns are mostly affecting the prediction of loan status. After doing that, okay, then I have got the data now. Now this data has 9 columns. 10th column is a ID column, which I am not mentioning. I want to split this data in 2 parts, one for the purpose of the training and another for the purpose of the testing. Okay, so here I have dragged this split data. Now from where split data comes? Split data comes from data transformation. So that I dragged here. Okay, and now these are the parameters I have given. I am splitting the data with a ratio of 70 to 30. So 0.7 means 70% data I am choosing for the training purpose and 30% data I am choosing for the testing purpose. Okay, so what it will do is, now it will give me 2 output points. One point gives me training data and another point gives me testing data. So now let me take you to the output. And here is a training data it will show to me. So 429 rows it has chosen. Now these are 70% rows out of 613 rows which were there in earlier data set. Okay, so this is 70% rows. Okay, testing data 30% rows, 184, 30% rows. So I have splitted data in 2 parts. Here it hasn't changed the data, it hasn't changed the number of columns in the data. Splitting data hasn't splitted columns. What it has splitted is number of rows. Okay, how different ways you can apply for the splitting also? So randomized splitting, okay, randomized seed also can be given, stratified splitting, so different types of splitting we can apply here. And here I am asking you to split by the rows. So training data, then I have to submit to the training model. So here, which model I want to create, which algorithm I want to use. So here I am dragging linear regression. So I choose for linear regression. Okay, it is under regression head. Okay, so in case if I take you to the machine learning algorithms, so inside machine learning algorithms, see this is a whole list of the different algorithms available. So most of the prominently used algorithms are available here. So here is a linear regression. As far as algorithms are concerned, okay, mainly these algorithms are of 3 types: regression algorithms, clustering algorithms, and classification algorithms. So regression algorithm. Here I am choosing regression algorithm, although I can choose classification algorithm also. This is an example of a classification algorithm also. Because you know why classification algorithm? Whether this customer will return the loan or will not return the loan. Will return the loan means value 1. And will not return the loan means value 0. Will return the loan means true. Will not return the loan means false. So it will have 2 categories only. 2 classifications only. So in case if I want to get the prediction in the form of yes or no, true or false, I would have chosen for classification algorithm. But what I am expecting here is it should show me the result in terms of a value below 0.5. Below 0.5 means fewer chances of returning the loan. And above 0.5 means more chances of returning the loan. So I do not want 0 or 1. I want actual number which will give me most likelihood of returning the loan. So number what it will return will be a fraction. It will not be 0 or 1. It will not be representing one class. Class of customer returning the loan or class of customer which are becoming defaulter. Okay, so that's why I'm expecting a float number here, real number here. Okay, number towards one will ensure me more likelihood of returning the loan, and number towards a zero will give me idea that less likelihood of returning the loan. That's why linear regression I have chosen. I can choose another regression techniques also. Rather, you know, while creating the pipeline, we normally choose multiple algorithms. Here I have chosen one algorithm only. So let me explain for one algorithm first. Okay. So that algorithm and training data I am submitting to that training model. Then testing data I have to, no, this will create a training model. It will create a trained model. That trained model then I have to test by using test data. Now with what, with this, what will happen? Now I will take you to the trained model. See the output. Here it will give me a trained model. Now this trained model has two things embedded within it. And that those two things are the algorithm and training data. These two things are embedded within it. This trained model, okay, after it has created this trained model, you can see under this option also. So there is a trained model it has created. Here it is. It has created trained model here. Okay, so going back to the designer. So trained model it has created. Then I have to apply the scoring of the model. So here I am applying the scoring of the model. It means in scoring, what it will do, it will apply its own prediction on every value. So let me show you the output of this. Okay, so here is the output of score model. So from there, you will come to know what exactly score model is doing with the data. And here you will observe. This is loan status. This is loan status column. 0, 1, 0, 1, 1 means successfully returned a loan. 0 means a person got defaulted while returning the loan. Okay, and here it is creating a score labels. Score label means 0.6 means it is beyond 0.5. So likelihood of returning the loan is more. For 0.28, likelihood of returning the loan is less. 0.8 is means likelihood of returning the loan is stronger than 0.68. So there are new column. There is a new column it has created in the scoring. This column then we will have to compare with this loan status. We have to compare it. Okay. And when we compare it, then we come to know whether prediction, how many predictions are really correct and how many predictions are really wrong. So from the number of correct predictions, from the number of wrong predictions, then it will give me the actual performance of the. So for that purpose, then I have to do the evaluation. What evaluation will do, it will compare the loan status column with a scored model column. And there then it will try to calculate the performance. So from here, I can get the performance now. And the performance of this model, mean absolute error, mean root mean squared error. So smaller the error is, greater is the performance. Okay. And so anyway, here we are getting some figures. Okay. Getting the figures from one model are not sufficient. What in the same pipeline I can do is, okay, I can choose for another algorithm, maybe boosted decision tree regression algorithm that I can drag here. Now, this is another algorithm I can choose. Okay. And then I can create another trained model here. Okay. And algorithm and training data I can submit to the another trained model. On that another trained model, then I will apply a score. Okay, so another score activity, I will have to get to that activity. I will have to submit testing data. And to the scored model, then I will do that scored model, then I will submit here. So there are two inputs from evaluate model. One input from linear regression scoring, And another input will be for from Bush decision tree regression. And then we can do a comparison here also, and we can come to know which algorithm is working better. Whenever I choose any algorithm, there are something called as a hyperparameter associated with every algorithm. Hyperparameters also decide performance of that algorithm. And we cannot judge hyperparameters. Okay, we have to try the model with a different hyperparameters. Okay, so either I can choose a new algorithm here, or I can choose same algorithm, but with a different set of hyperparameters. So if I choose same algorithm, I will have to change the hyperparameter here. Every algorithm has different sets of hyperparameters. This is regularization weight, which is hyperparameter for linear regression. But for different versions, different algorithm, there are different hyperparameters. Understanding the hyperparameters is that study goes under different machine learning algorithms. So I can choose for another algorithm with a different set of hyperparameters, and I can design another pipeline here, and that pipeline I can submit to the evaluate model, where I can do the comparison. After identifying the best model, okay, other model I will remove from here, and then finally, now say this model perhaps is not performing well, okay, so I can delete that. I can delete its evaluation and I can delete its complete pipeline. Now this is the model which I want to keep for this model, then at last I will submit it, okay, at last, because now the next step is to publish this model for production. Okay, so I will submit it at last. And when I submit it at last, it will test again whether all these activities are properly executed or not. Okay, and finally, then it will ask me to deploy it. Okay, so it asks me to deploy, it asks me to create a real-time pipeline. In real-time pipeline, pipeline is similar, but that pipeline does accept a data not only from the data set. Here it is accepting the data from the data set, but it will accept the data from the web service also. So there will be two input sources. One is a web service and another is a file, data, the CSV file. Okay. So now here you observe it has executed all these steps. And here it is asking me to create inference pipeline. I already have created inference pipeline, so I will go with update inference pipeline. Okay, and I click for real-time inference pipeline. Okay, and now it will create a new pipeline. Sorry, it has already created one pipeline. Just a minute, let me show you. It has already created a new pipeline. Here it is. Okay, what it has done is, it has updated that pipeline. So see, the updation has been done by just now. Okay, it has done the updation just now. And here is the another pipeline. Okay, this another pipeline is evaluated from the earlier pipeline only. And to this pipeline, you observe there are two inputs. One is the data set. This is the same data set of the CSV file. And this is a data which will come from web service. So this input basically is for production. This is basically for production level. Okay, and then once we get the data, we may be applying the different steps here. Okay, and finally, we are taking the output. Here we are taking the output. So this output means the prediction. Okay, and after I do this, this is what I did not do. This is what this action I did not add. This is what it has added the action. It itself has added the action. Okay, finally, I run this and I am running this, and then I will deploy it for production purpose. Okay, so when I run this, it means now this pipeline is validated and is made ready. It has been made ready, okay, for the purpose of the deployment. Remember, it is not instantiated. It has been instantiated, but for a testing environment only, for development environment only, it has yet not been instantiated on the production environment. Okay, so all these steps are executed Yes. And then after it has been validated and tested on the development environment. Okay, development environment means I am talking about the compute, that instance compute I am talking about. Okay, then I have to do the deployment. But when I do the deployment, at that time, it needs a separate cluster. It needs a separate cluster. So now let me take you to the another cluster. So I will come back to this later. Let me take you to the another cluster now. This cluster is for notebook. This cluster is where we are executing all the activities of the designer pipeline. This cluster is Kubernetes cluster. This cluster is for production. Okay, while creating this cluster, what I did is, okay, I have chosen the size of this cluster and I have chosen that this is Kubernetes cluster. Okay, and in this cluster, I kept this cluster open ready for you. So this is for Kubernetes service. So Kubernetes cluster it has created. Okay, and while creating this cluster, it did ask me for how many instances it should create. So there I have chosen one instance, but I am free to choose as many minimum instances and maximum instances I want to choose. Okay, it did ask me configuration of the machine also, how many CPUs the machine will have, how much RAM that machine will have, everything it did ask me. So in case if I want to create a new cluster, see what things it does ask me. Okay, from here it asked me the virtual machine size, region. Okay, I chosen for dev test. But if you want to treat this as a Kubernetes cluster for production, you can go with this. And number of nodes, minimum 3 for production, I can choose as many nodes as I want. Okay, so this is the way I can create the production cluster also. So on this production cluster, now we will do the deployment. So I go to the designer again. I go to the real-time inference. And here then, I click on deploy. It will deploy on that Kubernetes cluster. It will deploy this service on the Kubernetes cluster. Okay, and after it deploys that service on the Kubernetes cluster, now here it is asking me to do the deployment. Okay, I choose the cluster and I click on deploy. Now it will deploy all these things on Kubernetes cluster. Okay, I already have deployed this thing. That's why it is showing me that this is already existing. Okay, so let me show you the deployed cluster, deployed service here. So I can see that deployed service from the endpoints. And here is that deployed service. Here is that deployed service. And that deployed service I can see from here. Again, I repeat, this service is up and running with REST endpoints on the Kubernetes environment. REST endpoints. Okay, this is AKS, Kubernetes deployment state is healthy. Okay, so all that information is appearing here. Okay, you can test it from here. You can go to consume, and from here you will see different keys to access the service. Not only that, from here you can see the code to access the service. Here is a code to access the service. This code you can use in your application and you can query the service by submitting the real-time data. So here you will observe, this is some real-time data I am submitting. Okay, and it will run the service. Okay, this code you will have to use in your application. So it is giving me ready code also. It is giving me ready code also. This code that you have to copy paste from here and run in your application, and you will start getting the predictions. You will start getting the predictions. So very easy to create this pipeline. Let me know any question on this. And let me know whether I am accessible to all of you. This is all about the designer.
Can we run multiple algorithms in parallel?
We can run multiple algorithms in parallel. But if you want to use these algorithms for the purpose of the comparison, okay, then this designer does not allow me more than two algorithms to run. there are only, so there is a limitation here that this evaluation activity can accept two endpoints only. This is for one algorithm, this is for another algorithm. Algorithms are executed in parallel there. But more than two algorithms I cannot use here for doing the comparison. That is a limitation with the designer.
Okay.
But if you... yes, go ahead, please.
Like the new libraries which are coming now, which automates the model selection procedure and hyperparameter tuning like PyKaret and AutoML. Those libraries are also included in this Azure Machine Learning or not?
Those libraries are already available in Azure Machine Learning. That is the second point of my discussion. So once this designer is over, then I will start with AutoML.
Okay, sir.
So how we decide we have to take the Kubernetes services or virtual machine or independent virtual machine, how like decide the load for the deployment?
Now here see, Kubernetes service is really available, okay, and you don't have to manually create the cluster and you don't have to manually manage that cluster. Okay, so Kubernetes service is the best choice here because you can scale your cluster. You can scale up it, you can scale down it as per the necessity.
But it is compulsory to take, or how about the charges and all? It is like maintain within the machine learning, this studio, or how it is like separately manage the charges
Here see, whenever your cluster is up and running, your billing starts. Now here you observe, this particular cluster I started 1 hour before our session. From that point, it has started incurring the cost on my bill. That is one thing. Second thing is, if you don't want to go with the AKS cluster, okay, you can go with other clusters also from here. Okay, bring your own compute like HD Insight cluster, virtual machines, or a Databricks cluster. So other than AKS cluster, if you want to go with, that is also possible through attached compute. Okay, as far as charges are concerned, yes, you'll have to refer to the Azure documentation to see, to compare two types of clusters, a virtual machine cluster with a AKS cluster. That comparison you can do by going through. You know, there are tools also. What is that tool? Compute. That tool helps me to calculate the billing. Okay, it billing computation. Okay, that tool helps me to calculate the billing. Okay, so there also I can do the comparison. I can get the estimate of the resources. So that is possible. Okay, but you will have to refer the documentation for that purpose.
Is there any way to do these computations on the local laptop or desktop for the development or testing purposes?
For development and testing purposes, yes, there is a way. Okay, Azure Notebook service is available. Azure Notebook service. Notebooksazure.com. Here it asks you to create the instance. Okay, this is one way possible where you will be given. Now here it opens the Jupyter. Okay. And yes, this is a cloud service. I think I'm not giving you the answer exactly what you are asking about, but this is something in addition. Okay, I'm mentioning that through the notebook also you can do the development. In this case, what it does is it uses compute of the cloud. This compute is available as a free for you. Okay, for smaller activities, you can go with this compute also. Okay. But if you want to do development,
talking about Jupyter notebook, correct? A Jupyter notebook, correct? Which is internally managed.
I am talking about Jupyter notebook, but that service is readily and freely available along with the compute through the Azure notebook service. That is one thing. Another thing is Azure service. As of now, I am not aware of any Azure service which will provide me compute and development environment on premise. What I did here is, there is one more thing I have done. Just a minute. Where is that code? Okay, I think I closed it. But I installed Python and Jupyter Notebook on my machine. And there then it used compute of my machine. It did use compute of my machine. After I did everything, okay, then I can do the deployment there on the cloud. That I can also do.
So, but if we are developing on our local machine, and then we want to deploy it on some other platform, and like every platform has different format of deployment. Like Azure is having different format of deployment. So if we are developing in Azure, can we deploy it on other platforms as well?
See here, we will have to, in order to make everything possible, what we will have to do is, we will be using SDK here, Azure SDK here. So this Azure SDK will create every object for deploying all these things on the Azure ML service. And that Azure SDK is downloadable, is installable in your Jupyter notebook, and all the say, cloud services you can handle from on-premise. That is possible. So Azure SDK is available.
But this is portable to then Google Cloud Platform or AWS also, you mean to say, finally?
No. Okay. It will not be portable there. Huh? But whatever model it will create, it will be meant for... it will be created by Azure SDK, and it will be meant for Azure ML service. Just to add here, you can use Databricks also. And Databricks also can use Azure ML service integration. And Databricks also can use SDK, Azure SDK. And from there also, you know, deployment we can do on Azure ML service.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, thanks.
Yes. One thing we can make possible, that whatever be the Python model created, that will be deployable in the Python environment on other services also.
Chandra, just if you can just repeat the steps to you know, work on the desktop kind of thing, like what are the things that just... Can you repeat the steps? What things needs to be done to start working on the development? I mean, to work on the desktop kind of thing.
Okay, like, okay. So what I did here is, I have Jupyter notebook somewhere. Just let me think. Okay. Just a minute. Let me start a Jupyter. What I did is I installed Python on my local machine. Okay. And... Python is installed on local machine. These are, okay. And then Python allows me to start one server for desktop development. Okay, so here I have started this server. The steps for installation of Python and starting this server are already available in Python documentation. So I started the server. Now on this server, there is one URL somewhere it is giving me to start the Jupyter notebook. Now, first in the Jupyter...
Python, right?
Sorry?
First, we need to install Python.
Yes, we have to install Python first, and you will have to install IPython NB also. IPython also. Okay, so steps you will get on the in the Python documentation. When you install Python and IPython, okay, there now it gives you this kind of server, this window is a server window. This is a kind of a web server, okay, which gives me, okay, and through this server now it allows me to access a Jupyter notebook. So somewhere, okay, here is a URL to start the Jupyter notebook. So let me copy this URL, copy, and in the browser let me start the notebook. Here I think I have started already, okay. So this is the Jupyter notebook I have started. Very few steps are there to make your Python and Jupyter notebook ready. Very few steps are there. Within half an hour, you can make it ready. Okay, so I have installed it and I have started it here. Okay, and here then I can create a Python notebook, and here is a Jupyter notebook where it will ask me to mention different Python commands. And here you will observe different Python commands I am giving. Okay, in this Jupyter notebook, NumPy, Pandas, I am getting up and ready. Yeah. I don't have to issue pip command for that. But for SDK, Azure SDK, I will have to issue pip command here. Okay, once I issue pip command here, then Azure SDK also I get ready here. And through the Azure SDK, then I can handle every activity on Azure ML service. So that is also possible.
Okay.
So from on-premise also you can do it.
But the UI which we are getting through the like on the ML Azure ML service, that we cannot get.
I'm not pretty sure about it because some new feature they have introduced. I will have to check whether now they have introduced the Azure Stack service for ML development also. That I will have to check.
Okay, so this way we have to just write the scripts and then we can execute the thing.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes. Okay. So now it is high time for me to go for Azure Auto ML. So for going for Azure Auto ML, okay, there also here is an option available. Okay, and here I already
one
have
created second. Chandra.
Yes. One
second. Just a suggestion. Can we have a 5-minute break or you want to continue?
I don't mind taking a break, but
5 minutes max to max.
Yes. No issue. We will manage 5 minutes. No issue. Yeah, okay. Thanks. So let's take a 5-minute break. We will come within 5 minutes sharp. Okay?
Yeah. Thanks. Thank you.
Yes.
Sir, I have a question related to this sessions. So is there any certification will be provided that we have attended this? So like that.
The right person to check with this query is Shilpa Avhad. Okay, she can guide you such queries. So better connect to her only.
Okay. So actually, I am learning.
Hello, voice is gone. Please come back again.
Hello, am I audible?
Hello. Yes, now you are audible.
So actually, I am learning all this machine learning based on this Jupyter notebook. Doing everything on that. But the thing is, like in Azure, everything is just drag and drop. So we need to know like every algorithm to its fullest to work on this Azure ML.
Not everything is drag and drop. There are lots of customization we may have to do in real life scenarios, and those customizations we can make possible through this notebook option or this automated ML option. So that is possible. So not everything is drag and drop. We may have to do lots of customizations, and those features are also available here in Azure ML service. So customizations are possible. What is your next question?
So my next question is like, is there a career option? Like if I am learning machine learning only based on Azure ML, so is there a career in this only?
Azure is one of the fastest growing platform as on today. And it is acquiring much stake in the market. So I think this is my honest opinion, that Azure ML service and Azure platform is giving tough competition to AWS. And, you know, it is slowly surpassing, quickly surpassing, not slowly, it is quickly surpassing business take in the market. So even if you go for Azure ML service, your decision will not go wrong, that I can assure you.
Thank you so much, sir.
Hello. Hello. So, sir, just before some time, you said that these Azure ML services can be integrated with the Azure Databricks, right? Hello, can you hear me?
Yeah, yeah, we can hear you, but I think there is a break of 5 minutes. So,
okay.
In 2-3 minutes, everyone will return.
Hello. Azhar, you are back?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. Yes, Chandra.
Yes. Okay, now I'm taking you to the notebook. I believe everybody is back, or will I wait for next 1 minute?
Yes, sir, I have one question. Just before some time, you said that this Azure ML services can be integrated with Azure Databricks. So, but the Azure Databricks also are providing these ML features. Like they have the experiments, we can create the experiments there, we can have the data sample over there. Then, what is the difference that why we should connect the ML services with Databricks?
Now, see, if Azure Databricks, in Azure Databricks, I can create a model. From the model, I can create a PKL file. I mean to say PKL file. But Azure Databricks does not have its own way of, you know, publishing this PKL file for the production. For that purpose, Azure Databricks has to rely on third-party servers. So from the Azure Databricks, I can create a PKL file. I can create a model. And then I can use Azure SDK, ML SDK, to publish those models onto the Kubernetes. For the production purpose, I can use Azure ML service. So whole development I can do in Databricks, and publishing of the model for the production purpose I can do here in Azure ML service. So Databricks can publish on third-party tool, so Databricks also can be used to publish the models on the Azure ML service. Getting me?
Yes, yes.
Yes, yes. Okay. Here now I will show you a couple of steps of automated ML. We are running out of time. So I will be little bit fast forward the discussion. Now, in case if you already have worked on a Python, so understanding these steps are not challenging for you. Okay, here you observe. In this notebook, okay, SDK is already available. You don't have to issue pip command to install SDK, Azure SDK here. If you are using Jupyter notebook, here I have to issue pip command to install Azure SDK. If you are using a notebook service, here is a notebook service. Okay. In notebook service also, I don't get Azure SDK ready available. Okay, but here I will get Azure SDK ready available. Yes. Okay. So if you want to do extensive Python development, it is not going up. Routine toolbar. Just a minute. Okay. So here you observe just a couple of imports I am doing, and I am checking with the Azure SDK version. So here it is showing me Azure SDK version. Okay, now on whenever I created Azure ML service, at that time I already have named the workspace. I want to get the reference to that workspace. So workspace, experiment, pipeline, all these are the different artifacts created. Okay, I want the references for these, then I have ready API for that. So here is the name of the ML workspace, here is the resource group inside which that workspace got created, and here is the subscription ID. Here I am getting the reference to the workspace. From the workspace, if I want to see the detail, that is also possible. So here are all details of the workspace. So all the details of the workspace are possible. Through the Python code, if I want not to get the reference to the already created workspace, but I want to create a new workspace, that is also possible. So there is a command available here, create command, through which even workspace also can be created. So this API is available there, which will create the workspace. Okay, now here, I can pick up the data from the data set also. Okay, here I am picking up the sample data which comes with the scikit-learn. So scikit-learn has some ready data available. So from there, then some sample data I am loading, and here I am creating a data frame. So here I am getting the data frame, and from the data frame, now this data frame has data and a target. Target means, now this is the iris flower data. In this iris flower data, there you will see around 5 columns. Okay, 4 columns are width and breadth of the petal, width and breadth of the sepal. These are 4 columns, and the 5th is category or classification of that iris flower. There are 3-4 types of iris flowers. Okay, so here it will the 5th column is the category of the iris flower. Yes, and what prediction we are expecting here is, from the given sepal and petal length and width, I want this model to predict the category of the iris flower. Virginica and so some names, one name I could remember, other names I am not able to recall. Okay, Virginica is one of the classification of iris flower. So then I am splitting the data, then I am finding the size of the data. So here is the data size. Okay, and then I have to create the experiment. So in order to create the experiment, some information here I am giving, and experiment object is getting created. It will create experiment object. Now what is experiment actually? Experiment is object which holds the status of different runs of the model. Model runs it holds. Okay, so in which model run, how much time it has taken to complete the running, what is the performance of that model, every information it holds. This information is useful to us to do the comparison among the different models. Okay, so some other information I am giving to it, okay, this is the configuration information what I am giving to it, and then okay, so output data frame I am creating here. So this is the output data frame I am creating, okay, just to see the information. Okay, and here is then AutoML config. So what AutoML does is AutoML will apply here. I am submitting to it which kind of algorithm I want to. I want it to automatically apply, whether it is a regression algorithm, whether it is classification algorithm, or whether it is a clustering algorithm. So here I am mentioning it as a classification algorithm. Whenever I mention a classification algorithm, there again I am asking it to do the iteration. How many iterations it has to do? What it will be doing is internally it will apply different algorithms. For every algorithms, it will apply different what we can say the different hyperparameters it will apply. Okay, and for every algorithm it will calculate the performance also, and then that calculated on the basis of the calculated performance it will give me best performing algorithm. So this is just a configuration I am setting, nothing more than that. Okay, but here you observe different 25 iterations I am asking it to do, it will be creating different 25 models. If you recall in the designer, I told you not more than 2 models we can create. Here I can decide how many models I want it to create for me. Okay, so here is the configuration only, and when this configuration I submit to the experiment, okay, what experiment does, just observe, this is the output of the experiment now. Okay, here is the output of the experiment, and here you observe the output. This output, this execution would have taken 20 to 30 minutes to complete. And these are the different algorithms, Light GBM, okay, XG Boost Classifier, SGD, different algorithms it has applied, and different scalar algorithm also it has applied. Scalar calculation also it has applied. So 25 different permutations and combinations it did here. And again, a couple of figures you observe that, just observe that best wala column. Just observe that best wala column also. That best wala column is giving me that initially when it executed this algorithm, 0.9959 was the performance. Then the performance of this model was little bit smaller, so it considered this model to be best performing. Then another model has a further smaller performance, further less comparison, so further less performance. So it continued with the model number 0, model number 0. This is model number 0. So it kept applying and creating a different models, and it kept finding out the best performing model. Now here it got further better performing model 9963. This is model number 9963, considered to be now best performing model. So now it has chosen model number 9 as a best performing model. Then again it created a couple of other models, and up to this point the model number 9 was the best performing, but for voting ensemble it got another model, okay, which is performing better. So model number 23 is considered to be the best performing model. And here then, if you see these steps, don't bother about the steps written here. Try to understand exactly what we can make possible here. Okay, so don't bother about the steps. Here is a comparison of the different performance matrices. Okay, from these figures only, it realized which model is the best performing. Okay, and here if you see, if you run this, it will show me the details of the best performing model. So ID for this best performing model is 23. So 23 is the best performing model which I brought to your notice. 23. So thereby it has found the best performing model. Then I can, you know, register the model and then I can test the model. So here are a couple of other steps to make that model ready for the purpose of the production. So here are the steps we are using to deploy the model here. ACI service we are creating. Here we are actually deploying the model. Actual model deployment is happening here. And after that model is deployed, in case if we want to test the model, we can test the model from here. So again, everything we are making possible through Python code. For this purpose, what is essential is you must know the Python and you must have good knowledge of the Python SDK. Okay, so in case if you want to do small pipeline, in case you want to apply not much customized things, okay, there you go with a designer. Okay, but in case if you want to, your pipeline is complex, your activities are complex, okay, and you have, say, benchmark of performance, in that case, you go with Azure AutoML. In Azure AutoML, okay, n number of algorithms, sorry, models it creates and chooses the best one out of them. Okay. Let me know, is it audible to everyone?
Yeah. So do you have any lab exercise for this somewhere in a Microsoft website or somewhere else so that we can, after this your session?
Yes, you can go with Azure documentation. You can go with Azure documentation. There are labs available there in Azure documentation also. So I go to Azure MLWS. From the documentation, there are samples in GitHub also. Okay, so there are many, many samples available on GitHub. View more samples at GitHub. Okay, so documentation, Azure is known for its rich kind of documentation.
Okay.
Yes, any queries on this? I have completed agenda for today's discussion. Let us go into question answer session and thereafter we will conclude the session.
I have a question. Can we get the recording of this, Chandra?
I will check with Shilpa. I am not aware whether we have that policy. Okay, or Manish. I will request, may I know who is speaking?
This is Madhu Babu. Madhu.
Okay, I will inform them to address your query.
Yeah, sure.
Sorry.
Thank you.
Yes.
So this is a Microsoft like a sponsored training. So Microsoft also provide some of the like $100 of some that we can we can add into subscription to do that.
Yes, yes. So we are offering certification courses also. We have already declared the planner, monthly planner for that. If you have joined right from beginning, you would have seen that planner there. In case if you join such courses, there are individual courses available. There are package of courses available also. Okay, if you join individual courses or package of courses, you will get those subscriptions as a part of that package only.
Okay, not in this, okay. Yes. Because like earlier, I have joined some of the Microsoft session, so that time they have like for those 3 months they have like given $100 to try. Yes, on
yes, that scheme is also already available, but not for such 2 hours of session. You will have to join the certification sessions for that.
Okay.
3 days off, 4 days off. So there, then the $100 of certification is extensively needed, definitely needed for doing rigorous hands-on.
That's fine. It's also like a free subscription available on the credit card. Yeah.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah. Yeah. Can we practice all these things using Visual Studio MPN subscription? I think I already have a Visual Studio MPN subscription. Can I use that to do the to do all these exercises, Chandra?
I will have to check it because you know so many subscriptions are available. okay, whether these analytical services are available through NPM suspicion, that I will have to check.
Okay.
In case if you can inquire about this with Shilpa, she will revert back to you.
Okay.
Yes. So,
are we going to get the copy of this notebook? You just showed the AutoML. The exercise.
I will convey this thing to Shilpa. Okay. She will be a right person to make recording available to you and artifact that are used here.
Okay, can we just provide some more information on data pre-processing and data cleaning?
Yes,
like what are the various methods and in which scenarios, what are the suitable methods we should follow or the steps we should be doing for having the clean data so that we can pass the data to the model for training? Because that is the main part of as a data scientist, because if we don't have a good data, then there is no benefit in doing ML on that.
Yes, data quality is a key of success. Quality data is a key of success for your ML processing. Okay, actually, a couple of slides I will take you through, but otherwise, whenever we arrange a courses, where it takes around half a day for us to cover this topic of what are all different cleaning transformation algorithms we apply on what kind of data. Okay, I will quickly go through a couple of topics. See, whenever data is missing, then mean of the data, mode of the data, or median of the data, or sometimes standard mean of the data, mode of the data, that is to be replaced by missing data. Sometimes we may have to calculate the aggregate to reduce the data in the size. So in order to apply different cleansing techniques, okay, there are different methods available. And again, you don't have to write a low-level code for that. So there are cleansing methods available in Pandas library. There are cleansing methods available in NumPy library also. So different cleansing methods we can apply here. Okay. So aggregation we have to apply to reduce the data into the size. Okay. Then we can pool the data from variety of the sources. So these are steps for data preparation. So cleansing is one of the step here. For cleansing, what is necessary is what kind of different data are there. So categorical data is there, and then the different types of data we have to first of all understand. Okay, and from the different types of data, then we have to decide on which kind of data, which kind of cleansing mechanism we can apply. But yeah, for that purpose, you know, from the basics we will have to understand. I will not be in position to cover
Chandra, I'd like to say something about it, because this is not a small part. It depends on the business requirement and the data quality, like it's a categorical data or numeric data. Depending on that, we have to choose the selection process as well. So I think I'm just answering the her question, and so I'm just telling it's not about like for this business scenario we have to deal with the numeric data, so we can go with the normalization and standard deviation kind of things to scaling the data. But the categorical data, we have a lot of things to handle those data, and especially if it is image data or something, there are several other like procedure to handle those kind of scenario.
Yes, that is definitely right. And if you go to the Azure ML service, you will see lots of where it has gone. Okay, designer. Here you will see lots of steps we can follow. 1 minute, huh? Just let me. So here in data transformation, variety of data cleansing. Not here. Variety of data cleansing techniques are available there. Okay. See, so long list, and in every data cleansing technique, there are a number of sub options available. So it is really very rich of providing you cleansing and transformation techniques. Where to apply which cleansing and which transformation, again, it is a separate debate. You will have to hold a separate debate for that.
Yeah,
it's not possible in covering in so short span of time. So I regret for that. Any other question, please?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
I have already completed this data science course completion. So again, this is nothing but an extension of this. So what do you suggest for people like us, those who have already completed and those who are looking for job opportunities?
You have completed certification, your certification or certification?
Certified data science specialist.
Okay, okay. I think you can opt for Azure certifications. So there are three types of certifications for data scientist. For data scientist and data engineer. DP200, DP201, these are for data engineers, and DP100 is for data scientist. So whatever I have covered today, okay, is the highlights of DP100. If you further work on this, no, you will be ready for that certification. So I will suggest you to go for DP100 as of now to get a Microsoft certification. And
yes,
beyond this, then there are cognitive services, there are deep learning libraries. So different types of libraries are also available. So that is again a very interesting area to explore. So,
okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
So yeah. I think this is,
yes. Yeah, Chandra. So as you suggest, for this Azure Auto ML, we can use where we have multiple model needs to be designed and implement kind of thing, right?
Yes, sir.
And this Azure Studio, like the Azure Machine Learning service, we can use where we have less model needs to implement.
You are talking about designer, right? Azure ML
designer. So yes, in which case, like, can, like if you want to implement less model kind of things, then in that case we need to use this Azure designer kind of thing. Where, in which scenario you suggest kind of where?
Simple kind of pipelines.
Okay.
Simple kind of scenario. You don't want many models to be created, compared with a complex customization, okay? There you prefer this designer. Although designer is very rich, okay, but it is still not meant for much more customization. Although, yes, one level of customization is possible, that, you know, Python routines can be written for the features which are not available. Python and R language routines we can write. So customization is possible here also, but extensive customization is not possible.
Okay. So is it possible, like the output from the one model, like I created multiple models, a separate model. Okay. Mm-hmm. And output of those model I want to implement in the final model. Like I want to get in this pipeline, we have a, can you scroll down this pipeline? Till bottom. Yeah. So over here we are just scroll up. So is it possible to have a pipeline of one output or score model? We can have a input to another model and we can compare something like that.
No, see, maybe here, one model is doing one prediction for you. Okay, now if you are thinking of output of one model to be given to the another model, then it means the prediction of one model you are submitting to the another model.
No, sorry, my question was wrong. I mean, I have two different models, okay, in two different, I have created two different models in separate pipeline, and I want to compare those two models in another pipeline. Is it possible kind of thing? Like you said, like in Azure Auto ML, we can compare 20-25 kind of as you shown in example. Like we can see the which model gives better performance kind of thing. So in this, using the studio, Azure ML studio, can we do this kind of functionality? Like I created multiple models separately and I want to compare in another final pipeline. I want to compare those output.
I cannot answer you with assurance.
Okay.
This feature I haven't come across till to the date.
Okay.
There may be feature available which I haven't encountered. That's why.
Okay.
But I haven't come across such a feature till to the date.
Okay.
So I think it's a time for us to conclude. Okay. In case if you have further queries, my email ID is already with a Shilpa Award. You can send me email on that email. You can send me email with your questions. I will definitely revert back to you.
Sure.
Yeah, it was an excellent session. Thanks a lot for that.
So thanks all for your cooperation. Thanks. And for joining the session. Okay.
Thank you.
And
thank
hope you will take
this Chandra. Discussion.
Okay. Yes. Thanks all.
Thank you, Chandra.
Over to Manish. Manish, if you want to conclude the session, let me know.
Yes, sure, sir. Thank you so much, sir, for an wonderful session. So once again, here is an announcement. If you want a participation certificate, we will send an email on Monday regarding the feedback form and survey form. Please fill that form and revert us to through our mail. Or those who haven't received any mail or WhatsApp link, you have directly joined from your colleague. So just I have sent my mail ID in the message. So just mail me your details and we will send an feedback form and a survey form. So after that, you will get the participation certificate.
Your email ID, please. Hello.
Yeah. Yes.
Can you spell your email ID?
Yes.